And I ask that you please stay muted during the presentation. Please feel free to type questions in the chat box as we go along, and I will go over them at the end of the presentation. Or when we reach the end of the presentation, you can use the raise hand feature to unmute yourself and ask questions at the end. And so with that, I will get started with identification, surveying techniques, and reporting of aquatic invasive species. So invasive species are non-native species that can cause harm to the environment, harm to the economy, and/or harm to human health. Invasive species cause or contribute to habitat degradation and loss, the loss of native fish, wildlife, and plant species, which leads to reduced biodiversity, the loss of recreational opportunities and income or revenue, crop damage and disease in humans and livestock, and it also poses risk to public safety. So first, I'm going to cover some aquatic invasive species that you will most likely see if you're doing surveying in the Finger Lakes. And you should definitely report these in iMapInvasives, which we'll talk about later on. But some of these species, you don't necessarily need to notify others about them. And by others, I mean other water quality agencies or organizations, such as Cornell Cooperative Extension, Soil and Water Conservation Districts, PRISMS, which is the Partnership for Regional Invasive Species Management, DEC, or Fish and Wildlife Service. And I say that because these agencies are, you know, already aware that these species are widespread throughout most of the state and are probably already aware that they're in the water body that you're surveying in. But we'll talk about that a little bit more. So I'm going to start off with Eurasian water milfoil. Eurasian water milfoil is the most common aquatic invasive plant in New York, and it's pretty widespread throughout the Finger Lakes region. So you are more than likely to encounter this plant. It has very soft, feathery leaves that are attached to the stem in whorls of 3 to 5, and they develop small reddish flowers in the midsummer. And each one of those leaves that's whorled around the stem has 12 to 21 leaflet pairs. And they are green or reddish brown to purple. And the leaves, when the plant is pulled out of the water, the leaves are gonna fall limp down to the side of the stem. And this plant can sometimes be confused with native water milfoil, but one of the best ways to tell Eurasian water milfoil and native milfoil apart is that the native milfoil only has 5 to 10 of those little leaflets instead of the 12 to 20. And it's also much stiffer when removed from the water. It's less likely to drop its branches down to the stems as readily as Eurasian water milfoil. And the Eurasian water milfoil will sometimes get that reddish tint to the stem, whereas the native milfoil, the stem is green. Another common aquatic invasive species you might find in the Finger Lakes region is curly-leaved pondweed. And as its name implies, it has really curly, crinkly leaves that look a lot like lasagna. And they alternate along the stem and are green to reddish brown. The stem is flat and reddish brown and can grow anywhere from 1 to 3 feet in length. But unlike most of the other pondweeds, its leaves have a finely toothed edge. So I recommend that as you get started with doing some aquatic invasive species sampling and identifying, you get yourself a little hand lens or a good magnifying glass, because looking at those leaf edges or leaf margins to see if they are smooth or if they have teeth is going to be an identifying characteristic that'll really help you distinguish some of these invasive species from some of their native lookalikes. And then curly-leaved pondweed is visible really early in the growing season. So it actually starts to grow under the ice in early spring and is already done growing and starts to die back by 4th of July. And then curly-leaved pondweed can sometimes be easily confused with clasping-leaved pondweed. But as its name implies, the leaves clasp around the plant stems. And then quagga mussels and zebra mussels. You're probably gonna see these as well. They can sometimes be hard to tell apart, but the quagga mussels are a little bit bigger than the zebra mussels. And the zebra mussels usually have a flat edge to them. So they can kind of almost stand up straight if you try to lay them flat, whereas the quagga mussel is gonna tip over because it doesn't really have that flattened bottom. And then the Chinese mystery snail. This is a really large snail. Its shells can reach anywhere from 2.5 inches long with 6 whorls. The shell, the color of the shell can vary from olive green to brown to reddish brown. And they have an operculum or a trap door, which seals off the snail from water conditions. So if you find one of these shells that still has a snail in it, you'll notice that there's kind of like a little protective covering over the opening there to help protect the snail. And this one, I put this one under ones that you don't necessarily need to notify someone of, but if you do go to report this one in iMapInvasives and you see that there are no other reports of it in the water body that you are sampling in, then I would recommend that you reach out to someone. Because we do know that Chinese mystery snail is present throughout the Finger Lakes region, but we don't have a real good understanding of exactly where or how widespread it is, because it isn't one that has been mapped really well in IMAP invasives yet. So if you do see this one, report it in IMAPs. And like I said, if you don't see other reports of it, then go ahead and let somebody know. Fishhook and spiny water flea. Same with this one. We know that it's, you know, in locations throughout the Finger Lakes region, but again, don't have a real, real solid understanding of all the different water bodies that may be present in yet. So if you go to report this one in iMapInvasives, and again, don't see it previously reported in that area, then I would go ahead and notify someone. So fishhook and spiny water flea. They are two different species, but really hard to tell apart. They are very, very tiny. They are small predaceous crustaceans, and they only get about 1/4 to 1/2 inch in length. And they're pretty translucent, and individuals are really hard to spot. But when you will really notice them is when they clump together in masses. They usually get like clumped together on fishing lines, or on other gear. And this is when people really start to notice them. You can see that lower picture there. That's a cluster of them on a fishing line. And so now I'll go over a couple of different aquatic invasive species that, again, you should report in IMAP invasives. And then these, I would definitely recommend that you notify someone. So reach out to CCE, Soil and Water, PRISM, or DEC if you find these species. Water chestnut. So water chestnut, it has floating rosette-shaped leaves that produce a nut-like fruits with really sharp spikes. They have submerged feathery leaves that alternate on the stem, forming whorls. The leaves are triangular-shaped, and they are waxy on top and hairy on the underside. And they have stems underneath them that can reach lengths down in the water column of up to 16 feet. And this one, it's one that we know is present throughout the Finger Lakes region, but there's really good potential of highly effective management of this plant if it is addressed. So if you don't see other reports of this species in IMAP invasives, then let someone know so that, you know, they might have the chance to get some management practices in place. And then hydrilla. Hydrilla has very small pointed and toothed leaves. Again, you're gonna want that hand lens to look at the leaf margins because the leaves are pretty small on this plant. So you're gonna look for leaves in whorls of 4 to 8. The stems can grow really long, up to 25 feet in length or more, and they form really dense mats on the water's surface. The underside of the leaves feel scratchy because they have these little spines on the midrib of the leaf, which you can also see with your hand lens. And then the midrib on hydrilla is often reddish in color. And when pulled from the sediment, you might be able to see tubers attached to the base of hydrilla. And hydrilla can sometimes be confused with native elodea, but the elodea is gonna have whorls of three leaves, and you're not gonna see a real clear like toothing or serrated pattern on the leaf margins of elodea. There's one other plant, another invasive that looks similar to hydrilla and elodea to keep an eye out for, and that one is Brazilian waterweed. And starry stonewort. So starry stonewort is a macro algae, but it is very plant-like. It has leaf-like structures, and it's a very like gangly and stringy plant when pulled from the water. The branches are smooth and look like green gelatin. It's rooted by star-shaped bulbs, which may be visible in the late summer. And this plant reproduces really easily by fragmentation. And spreads really easily because of that. All it takes is a piece of the plant to get attached to a watercraft, and then that watercraft leaves without removing vegetation and enters another water body. The fragment of starry stonewort gets dislodged in another water body, and that is enough of that plant to start a new infestation in another water body. So that's why it's really important to clean, drain, and dry your boats when moving between water bodies. And then starry stonewort can be easily confused with cara or muskgrass, but when it's crushed, you're not gonna notice the musky odor that you will smell if you crush muskgrass. European frogbit has heart-shaped leaves with purplish-red undersides and is sometimes called the Valentine plant because of its really distinctive heart-shaped leaves. And it has white flowers with three petals, but European frogbit is very, very small compared to most of our native lily species. The leaves of European frogbit are only 1/2 inch to 2 1/4 inches of length and in length and width. And then round goby. Round goby is about 10 to 25 centimeters in length. It's got a mottled gray, olive green, and brown markings. The dorsal fin, which is the upper fin, may appear greenish in color sometimes, but it lacks spines. So it's not gonna be sharp or like pokey. And then sometimes the front dorsal fin, which is the smaller fin there up on top of the fish, sometimes it might have a black spot, but I wouldn't use the absence of that black spot as an identifying feature because there is an infestation of round goby in Lake Erie, and the round goby in Lake Erie, most of them don't have that black spot. So I wouldn't totally rule out round goby if you don't see that black spot. And the round goby has raised eyes. And it's also similar in appearance to native sculpin and the tube-nose goby. And then, there are other aquatic invasive species that pose a threat to New York State. So I would definitely, familiarize yourself with and keep an eye out for bloody red shrimp, water lettuce, water hyacinth, Brazilian waterweed. And as you get more familiar with the different species in the Finger Lakes region, and you see something that you haven't seen before, doesn't look like anything you can find, in any of your ID guides, then let someone know. And so now I'm just gonna go through some pictures of some of the native aquatic species that I already mentioned that you'll likely see and can sometimes be easily confused with those aquatic invasive species. So a native species that you're likely to see is eelgrass. This one's pretty distinctive looking from other things in the Finger Lakes region. Very grass-like, very flat, slender, long leaves. Elodea. This is the one that we talked about that looks similar to hydrilla or Brazilian waterweed. And then coontail in the lower left. This one can sometimes be confused with the milfoils. And then pondweeds. There are many different types of pondweeds present in the Finger Lakes region. Some of them you can see are submerged underneath the water and others float on top of the water surface. And that's the northern water milfoil at the top left there, which can sometimes be confused with the Eurasian water milfoil. And then naiad is another species that you might encounter. This one sometimes can look a little bit like milfoil or some other species, but it really has the leaves on it, the tips of them kind of curl down, and it has a lot of bumps along the spines of the leaves. And then cara or muskgrass. So this one is pretty easy to confuse with starry stonewort. They look pretty similar in appearance, but the leaves of cara or muskgrass aren't quite as long or gangly as starry stonewort. And when you crush that plant, you're really gonna notice that musky odor. And then just one other plant that I wanna point out to you that sometimes people get concerned with or want to know what it is duckweed. And duckweed is it's a very, very tiny little plant. But sometimes, as you can see right there, it gets pretty dense and it can cover, big areas of the surface of the water. So sometimes that can be concerning to people. So I just wanted to point that one out for you because you're likely to encounter that one as well. So now that we've gone over a couple different aquatic invasive species and some of the native species you might see, I'm just gonna go over with you how to survey. So I'm borrowing some slides here from Chris Doyle from Applied Biological. And this is the, probably the primary tool that you're going to need to do surveying. So what it is two long garden rakes with the wooden handles cut off. And then you're gonna secure the tines together back to back with hose clamps and then tape the handles together and attach a rope to it. I would give you yourself probably at least 35 feet or more in length of rope. And just some important reminders, make sure that, the rope is tied pretty securely to the tines of the garden rake. And then you might want to attach it somewhere to the boat as well, the other end of it, just so that you don't lose it in the water. Because that has happened to the best of us all. We have lost our rakes. So definitely attach the other end of the rope to your watercraft or to your dock. And then so what you're going to do with this contraption is toss the rake into the water, let it settle to the bottom, and then pull it, kind of drag it and pull it back into shore. So you can, you can drop this rake off the end of your dock, off, toss it in from the shoreline, or you can do surveying while you're out in a kayak or boat or canoe as well. And so you're gonna pull this in and take a look at what vegetation you have. And try to identify the vegetation that you collected. And as you get to reporting, we'll go over this a little bit more and different ways to report. But when you get to reporting these plants, you're most likely gonna have to assign an abundance to the amount of plants that you found. So the abundance values, range anywhere from no plants all the way up to dense plants. So I'm going to show you some pictures of what those different abundance values look like. So a trace amount of plants, you can see that there's just a few strands of plants attached to the rake. Sparse, the rake is, the bottom of the rake is covered with plants, but not really thick yet. And then when you get up to medium, the tines of the rake are getting kind of hard to see. And then dense. When you get up to something like a dense amount of vegetation attached to your rake, it's going to be heavy. It's going to be hard to pull up, and some of the rope's going to be covered, and the rake is going to be completely covered, and you won't be able to see your rake. And then we talked about a couple different floating aquatic plants as well. So this just gives you a visual idea of how to measure abundance for floating plants. So you can see trace amounts. There's just a few plants floating there on the surface. And by the time you get up to dense, most of the surface of the water is covered with the plant at that time. And then a really good program to get involved with that will also supply you with your rake. It'll supply you with ID. It'll provide training on how to identify plants, training on how to survey for plants, is the Finger Lakes Invasive Plant Detectors Program, or the macrophyte program. So this is offered through Finger Lakes PRISM and Finger Lakes Institute at Hobart and William Smith Colleges. And like I said, they'll go through all of the identifying, surveying, and set you up to report species that you find as well. So it's pretty much everything that you need to get set up reporting aquatic invasive plants. And you can do it in any water body that is closest to you. And if you are interested in being part of this program, you can sign up at fingerlakesinvasives.org. And I will get that into the chat box for you at some point if someone else doesn't do it sooner, so that you can click on that and check out their website and sign up to be a plant detector. And if you are joining from somewhere outside of the Finger Lakes, don't worry. PRISM is, there are 8 different regions, 8 different PRISMs across New York State. So you should be able to find a PRISM no matter what county you're located in, and get signed up to be a volunteer for the macrophyte survey program. And then if you don't sign up for the macrophyte survey program, but you still really want to report aquatic invasive species, you can do so in iMaps. So go to New York iMapInvasives. And so it's New York iMapInvasives.org. And you can sign up here to be able to enter reports. So this is when you go to the website, this is the homepage that you're gonna see. And right there along the top bar where I have pointed out with the red arrow, report an invasive. So you're gonna click on report an invasive, and then it is gonna take you through step-by-step all of the information that you need to enter. So you're gonna need to identify the species that you found. And it's really important to try to get a couple good pictures of the species as well. Try to get a picture of the whole plant, and then try to get a picture of some of the identifying details. Like, so some of those things that we talked about, how many leaves are whorled around the stem, or other characteristics that might really help someone know for sure what plant is being reported. And don't worry about being like an expert when you go to report in IMAP invasives. You know, do your best and record what you think that you are seeing. And there is somebody at the other end of this form that takes a look at your pictures and takes a look at your location, the water body you're reporting in, and they go through and look at all the information you've provided and verify that you've identified the species properly. And then also, if it is a new report in the water body that you are surveying in, they're gonna notify some of these agencies and other organizations that a new species has been detected, you know, for the first time in this water body, so that some action can be taken. And then you can download the app on your phone as well, so that you have it right there in the field with you. And with the app, it's really nice because it'll save all of your entries, and then you can download them once you get back home to Wi-Fi. So you don't need to worry about having a connection out in the woods or on the water. So you can just make all of your reports and then load everything when you get home. And then I would definitely, you don't have to create an account to make a report of an invasive species, but I would definitely recommend that you consider it. Because you can get a lot more information when you create an account. You can see all of the reports that you've made over time and see a lot of other information for the region on what's been reported. And with that, I am going to open it up so that we have time for questions and discussion. And I'll leave this screen up for just a minute if you want to take down my email address or telephone number. Definitely reach out to me if you have questions or need help identifying different aquatic invasive species. There are a lot of good aquatic invasive species guides available online. Or if you can't find one online that you like, I have some copies of really helpful guides with aquatic invasive species as well as some of their native lookalikes. So if you need a guide, let me know and I can get one to you. All right. So I'm going to take a look at what is in the chat box. Thank you, Frank, for putting the PRISM information in there and IMAP invasives. And then Kathleen, yes, I can make a PDF of the slides. And then I guess the group will have to figure out if we can make those available in the similar or same location as we're going to make them, right? I don't know, guys. I'll have to talk with the rest of the group and see if we can get PDFs of the slides available somewhere online. But you can also, again, take down my email address and I can email them to you as well. And I'm gonna stick my email address in the chat there too.
And the session will be recorded and available too. So folks, if you don't have actual slides, you can certainly rewatch. Yep.
Yeah, but certainly, yeah. I mean, you can definitely, if you save my slides as a PDF, you can use them as an ID guide as well. If there's any other questions, please feel free to put them in the chat box or go ahead and I think you can use the raise hand feature and then we can unmute you to ask a question. All right. I guess then if you,
you got it, Laura?
What's that?
So the question that came in is how do native species benefit the lake?
All right, so native species, they provide, one of the big things is that they provide habitat for our native like fish species and other aquatic organisms. And they also, as they break down, they supply nutrients to the lake as well. So they're, a part of the whole lake ecosystem.
So there is a question that is from our attendees. Is there a website or somewhere to see what has been identified in your specific lake?
Yeah, so you can use IMAP invasives for that as well. You can see different reports on IMAP. Finger Lakes PRISM usually has a really good collection of different fact sheets for different invasive species. And usually included on those fact sheets is a map of where the species have been found as well.
Thanks, Laura. A couple other questions are coming into the Q&A. One is, when should we expect to hear from someone regarding the macrophyte survey once we've signed up?
That I am not entirely sure on. That's a specific question for PRISM. So I would, if you have signed up for it and haven't, if it's been a little while and haven't heard anything, I would try to reach out to someone at PRISM.
Okay, thanks. Here's an interesting question. making connections, which aquatic invasive species have been shown to influence harmful algal blooms?
So there is some connection between quagga mussels and zebra mussels. So the way that, so quagga mussels and zebra mussels, they kind of selectively feed and filter out what types of algae they like. So they don't really like the blue-green algae, which leads to harmful algal blooms. So they might ingest it, but then they end up spitting it back out. So they end up, you know, kind of concentrating the type of algae that they don't like in the water column and making it a little more readily available after they kind of have processed it and regurgitated it back into the system. But even aquatic plants, just because of the dense abundance of invasive species, just all of that biomass, you know, so aquatic invasive species, they grow in much denser quantities than a lot of our native species. So it's a lot more vegetation at the end of the season when these plants start to die off and decompose. So it can sometimes be like an abundance of nutrients when that much vegetation starts to decompose, which can, you know, possibly be one of the contributing factors to the occurrence of harmful algal blooms.
Okay, thanks, Laura. And Frank is asking for any advice on managing snags with your rake toss.
I don't know, Frank. That one's a tricky one. And running into them with the canoe too, that one, yeah, not fun.
Laura, here's a question that came into the chat asking, do round gobies eat quagga mussels?
That I'm not sure. I don't know a whole lot about round gobies. I can't answer that one for you right now, but I can jot it down and try to get back to you. Or if you want to email me, then I can email some information back.
And also from Frank, is the presence of quagga mussels attached to macrophytes recorded as part of the survey?
Yes.
So we are caught up on questions right now. If anyone else would like to submit a question for Laura, now is a great time.
All right. Okay. Well, thank you everyone for tuning in tonight. And like I said, please feel free to reach out to me if you need help identifying anything, if you need an ID guide, or have any other aquatic invasive species questions.
Thanks, everyone.